this morning. I have asked you to come this morning in order for me to deal with three issues. The first issue is the state of emergency. The second issue is the disobedience of the order of the Court of Appeal made in favour of municipal police officers. This order was affirmed by the Privy Council as the final Court of Appeal for Trinidad and Tobago. The third issue concerns the implications of the government withdrawing the claim which it filed against Professor Ken Julien against the UTT and its directors. I also intend to deal with a fourth issue. The issue relates to the principle of responsible government, which is enshrined in the constitution of our country, and the impact of those principles on the governance today of Trinidad and Tobago. I have, since I became a lawyer in Trinidad and Tobago, stood up against governments when they trampled upon the rights of individuals and the public as a whole. I have also used the law to challenge governments in respect of those actions. The history of Trinidad and Tobago would show that I've been engaged in public campaigns against governments when they abuse and misuse power or fail to follow the constitution and the law. I have mounted campaigns against the PNM and the NAR governments. When I served as Attorney General of Trinidad and Tobago in the UNC government, I also stood up against the government of which I belonged, when I took the position that the public interest demanded that I took certain actions to protect the public interest of Trinidad and Tobago. In that context, I have a duty to assist the country in understanding the implications of responsible government to governance in Trinidad and Tobago at the present time. I would first deal, however, with the issue of the state of emergency. A state of emergency under the Constitution of Trinidad and Tobago can only be created on specified grounds as stated in the Constitution. This government created a state of emergency on the 21st of August 2011. The grounds given by the government and Parliament for creating the state of emergency was a threat to public safety in that there was a recent escalation of criminal activity, and it was fair that there would have been a risk of reprisal by criminal gangs as there were recent successes by the police in drug trafficking initiatives. Hundreds of persons were arrested and detained. The charges laid against them under the Anti-Gang Act 2011 had to be discontinued. The Director of Public Prosecutions intervened as there was no evidence to support the charges. The government therefore used powers of detention under the emergency regulations created by the state of emergency to detain persons in custody. During the state of emergency, it was announced that there was a conspiracy to assassinate the Prime Minister. Several persons were detained under the emergency regulations in respect of that alleged plot. It turned out that there was no evidence against the individuals who were detained and no charges were laid against them. The state of emergency lasted for approximately 3 months, and to date, the government has not given any explanation to the population to justify the creation of the state of emergency. A state of emergency can only be created when there is a real and genuine public emergency, which emergency cannot be dealt with by the normal measures available to the government. If a government can create a state of emergency whenever there is an upsurge in crime or fear of reprisals by criminal gangs, then Trinidad and Tobago would have to have a permanent state of emergency. These are normal threats and risks which a police service and a government face on a daily basis, and the normal measures of crime fighting are used to deal with these threats. The powers of creating a state of emergency in exceptional circumstances cannot be properly used for routine police work. It is an abuse and misuse of power to do so. Ashmeed Mohammed and Dominic Pitilal, two of the 17 persons detained on the alleged plot to assassinate the Prime Minister, commenced legal proceedings against the government for the High Court to declare their arrest and detention under the state of emergency was unconstitutional and for the court to award them compensation and damages for their imprisonment. Ashmeed Mohammed is outside and he will come in shortly after this press conference that you can interview him if you wish. And the wife of the other person is outside, and she can also be interviewed if you wish. Dominic Pitilal filed his action on the 29th of July 2015, and Ashmeed Mohammed filed his action 7 days before on the 22nd of July 2015. The matter for Dominic Pitilal is listed to be called up at the San Fernando High Court on the 15th of October 2015, and Ashmeed Mohammed's matter is listed to be called up on the 21st of October 2015. A police officer who was also detained during the state of emergency also commenced legal action against the government for his arrest and detention. He was a sergeant of police, and on the 23rd of November 2011, he was attached to the St. Clair Police Station, and he was detained under the state of emergency until the 5th of December 2011, when the state of emergency ended. He returned to work and was given compulsory vacation leave, and then resumed duties on the 2nd of May 2012, performing the same duties he had performed at the St. Clair Police Station when he was detained. In January 2013, he was promoted to police inspector and is still attached to the St. Clair Police Station. No evidence has been produced to these aggrieved individuals to show that they were involved in any plot to assassinate the Prime Minister. No evidence has been produced to show that there was any factual basis that they posed any threat to national security for them to have been detained. The Prime Minister stated that this was an act of treason against the state. No charge has been laid against them for treason. The Prime Minister or the Commissioner of Police has not given any explanation or produced any information to the Parliament to justify the actions of the government in creating the state of emergency. International law recognizes that a government cannot create a state of emergency unless it can show that the threat which the government fears could not be dealt with by using the normal measures available to it. It cannot be seriously asserted that in respect of the state of emergency which was created, the ordinary powers of the police and the criminal justice system could not be properly applied to deal with any threatened criminal activity stated in the grounds for creating the state of emergency. It did not need a state of emergency and emergency regulations for these persons to have been interviewed or for the police to investigate these allegations, even if there was any factual basis for these allegations. What makes matters worse is that a few days before the creation of the state of emergency, the Anti-Gang Act 2011 came into force, which created new offences and gave to the police and to the courts substantial new powers to suppress criminal gangs. It is clear, therefore, that the normal measures of the state were available to the government to deal with these allegations, and the creation of a state of emergency was totally unwarranted. It was a clear abuse of power under the Constitution to have created the state of emergency. It brought the constitution of our country into disrepute, and it has caused grave injustice not only to persons who were detained, but to families of those persons who suffered a grave injustice. I should mention briefly the circumstances under which Ashmeed Mohammed and Dominic Pitilal were detained. Ashmeed Mohammed was on the 24th of November 2011 at the Gulf City branch at Royal Bank when he was approached by 15 uniformed police officers with machine guns. They surrounded his van and took him into custody. They informed him that he was being arrested for illegal arms and drugs. There was no arrest warrant. They searched his van and took him to the Marabella police station. He was then taken to his home in Laramie, which was searched without a warrant. They said they were looking for guns, ammunition, and drugs. He was detained at the Freeport police station. He was interviewed whilst he was in custody, but was denied having a lawyer present for such interview. His house was searched a second time without any warrant. Dominic Pitilal, he was arrested on the 24th of November 2011 at his home in Kokorit. They searched his home without a warrant, as they told him they were acting under the powers of the state of emergency. At his home, they seized his religious books. He was handcuffed and escorted to the Maharaja police station, He was not informed of the reasons for his arrest. He was denied the right to have a lawyer present when he was interviewed by the police. In late February 2014, he traveled to Venezuela to obtain a visa at the Saudi Arabian Embassy in Caracas, and to then fly to Saudi Arabia for a pilgrimage. During his stay in Caracas, he and other Trinidadians became stranded due to instability in Venezuela. His hotel was searched, and he, along with other Trinidadian visitors, were detained by the police. As a result of the statements made by the officials in Trinidad and Tobago, he is detained in Venezuela since 2014 on allegations of terrorism and is accused of being part of an alleged plot to overthrow the Venezuelan government. His wife has filed an affidavit in court on his behalf. I will now deal with the UTT case. In 2011, the then Attorney General, Anand Ramlogan, established a group of persons whom he acknowledged to be his friends to advise on whether there had been corruption in certain state enterprises and in certain areas of public life. The state enterprises that the then Attorney General targeted included the University of Trinidad and Tobago, ETEC, and Petrotin. The other matters Anand Ramlogan identified for investigation included the Scarborough Hospital, the purchase of the MV Sue, and the sale of BWI slots at Heathrow Airport. The group of persons selected by him to do these investigations included Gerald Ramdin and Varun Debidin, attorneys at law. This group of persons described itself as a forensic audit team. Notwithstanding this description of itself, the group contained no forensic audit capacity and was entirely comprised of friends of Mr. Ramlogan. The so-called forensic audit team eventually recommended to itself that it should commence legal action against Professor Julien and others for alleged breaches of fiduciary duty in respect of their tenure at the University of Trinidad and Tobago and ETEC. The team also recommended that civil action be pursued against Malcolm Jones in respect of his tenure as Petrotrin. No recommendations were apparently made or steps taken in respect of any of the other matters. For its work, the team split up the sum of $45 million. To put this sum in context, it is more than Mr. Jeremy, when he was Attorney General, had spent to operate the entire office of the Attorney General a mere year before in 2010, when total expenditure on fees, legal fees, was $34 million paid to all external attorneys for all matters in which the Attorney General office was involved. It is also twice the amount ever paid by me as Attorney General during my stint as Attorney General in the period leading up to 2000. I held a press conference some months ago, together with Mr. Jeremy, to express my alarm at the $400 million that had been spent in less than 5 years in the office of the Attorney General by Anand Ramlogan. I subsequently wrote a letter to the Commissioner of Police calling for an urgent investigation into certain aspects of the $400 million expenditure. I have not yet heard from the Commissioner of Police. Today, I call on the Commissioner of Police and the Integrity Commission to investigate this matter. In particular, the fiasco of the UTT trial to determine whether offences under the Integrity in Public Life Act and the Prevention of Corruption Act were committed by the steps taken by the partnership government in this matter. I make this call in the light of certain revelations which led to the spectacular collapse of the UTT trial. These revelations include the evidence of witnesses for UTT who indicated that UTT acted as a mere rubber stamp to directives by the attorneys at law to bring the aborted legal proceedings. UTT's own witnesses described the shocking level of involvement by a senior member of the government in the proceedings against Professor Julien, which led the trial judge to declare that such proceedings ought not to be embarked upon lightly. I have discovered that Vincent Nelson, Queen's Counsel, advised the judge at the trial that he was ethically prevented from taking any further part in the proceedings. The trial judge, in an unprecedented development, invited the UTT to then apologize to Professor Julien. A criminal investigation is warranted to determine whether there was corruption by the government in spending $45 million paid for this unprecedented fiasco, or whether it was in fact an illusory payment for work done on a made work basis. Further, I call on the present Attorney General to discontinue with immediate effect all these civil actions, given the cautionary remarks made by Justice Kokoram in the UTT case. Prosecutions are the business of the Director of Public Prosecution, and where there is no evidence to launch a criminal prosecution, the Attorney General has no right to try to circumvent the functions and powers of the DPP to launch punitive actions of his own, especially where there can be the perception that there was a political motivation. Municipal police. I now deal with the municipal police issue. The Court of Appeal made an order for the government of Trinidad and Tobago to make regulations under the Statutory Authorities Act, which would facilitate municipal police officers to access the industrial court to have its disputes with salary, allowances, and other pay issues with the government determined by the industrial court. The Privy Council earlier this year affirmed that decision of the Court of Appeal, which mandated the government to make these regulations. The draft regulations which the government made by the then Attorney General, whilst the case was being heard in the Privy Council, was found by the Privy Council in its judgment to have been defective. Several efforts have been made by the municipal police officers and on behalf of municipal police officers to have the government remedy the regulations, but the government continues to disobey the order of the Court of Appeal and the order of the Privy Council. I have, on the instructions of the municipal police officers, drafted contempt of court proceedings to be filed against the former Attorney General and the present Attorney General for disobeying the orders of the Court of Appeal and the Privy Council. I have a meeting with the municipal police officers this weekend at which these draft proceedings would be discussed, and I hope action would be filed soon. I now come to deal with the principle of responsible government provided for in the Constitution as it applies to governance in Trinidad and Tobago. It is acknowledged and recognized by the International Commission of Jurists and the Center for the Independence of Lawyers, based in Geneva, the International Bar Association, the American and English Bar Associations, the Commonwealth Bar Association, that lawyers have a duty to play a key role in the promotion and advancement of constitutionalism, democracy, and the advancement of the rule of law in their respective countries. They have a duty not to collude with governments to become an apparatus of the government. Consequently, it cannot be disputed that lawyers have a special responsibility to the public to make the public informed of any failure of the government to obey the Constitution or to discharge its duty to account to the people in respect of its decisions and or actions. The Constitution of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago requires the government to govern the country in accordance with the principles of the doctrine of responsible government, see Section 75 of the Constitution of Trinidad and Tobago. This constitutional law principle of responsible government requires the government to account to the people in respect of its actions and its expenditures of public funds. Government normally does this accountability to the public through the Parliament. Where the decisions or actions of the government have caused public disquiet and public disapproval, the government is required by the principles of responsible government to justify its actions or decisions so that the public can feel satisfied that there was no misconduct on the part of the government. I am conscious that the people would, in the next 19 days, exercise their right to vote. They have the right and the power to retain the present government or to vote in another government. This right of the population to retain a government or to change a government is the basis of the famous description of democratic government, that is, government of the people, government by the people, and government for the people. Government held information is owned by the people. The people are entitled to know the information which government has when it makes a decision or when it takes action. When a government asks the electorate to give it a second term, it has a duty to give to the electorate all the relevant information to justify its decisions and actions which cause and continue to cause public disquiet and public condemnation. The government stands the risk that if it fails to give such material information to the electorate would not be able to make a proper assessment of the stewardship of the government, and the electorate can draw adverse inferences against the government. Where government refuses to justify such decisions and or actions by giving to the electorate all the material information which influence its decisions and actions, which cause public disquiet and condemnation, the government is in effect asking the electorate to give to it blind support. It was inconsistent with the spirit of the Constitution of Trinidad and Tobago and with the principles of responsible government for the Prime Minister to have allowed a period of almost 3 months to exist between the dissolution of Parliament on the 17th of June 2015 and the holding of general elections on the 7th of September 2015. This long period of time between the dissolution of Parliament and the date fixed for the general election has permitted, and it continues to permit, the government to expend public monies without facing contemporaneous scrutiny in the Parliament for such expenditures of public funds. This is a most unsatisfactory state of affairs because members of the opposition parties cannot, on behalf of the population, scrutinize the government in respect of its decisions and or action. Such a situation permits a government to use state resources for promoting its party in the general election campaign. Any exercise in the future to reform the constitution of our country, the public interest would demand that this defect in the Constitution be remedied, this loophole be plugged. Only this morning, it was published in the newspapers that in the recent fire at a grocery, the Prime Minister, as head of the government, intends to take action to compensate the fire victims as an act of mercy and to take steps to find employment for the displaced staff. Any reasonable citizen of Trinidad and Tobago would feel sympathetic to the families who have been adversely affected by this fire. The decision of the Prime Minister, however, brings into focus the question whether the Prime Minister is using this tragedy for election purposes, for campaigning for election. There was a fire in May of this year, MDC, UM, in which about 170 persons became unemployed, and there was about $80 million loss in property damage. The Prime Minister did not take similar action to assist the victims of that fire. From 2010 to 2015, many persons have been left homeless and jobless as a result of fire on premises, and the Prime Minister never once made a move to assist those families and businesses. Why she has the passion at this time to do that? Is it the upcoming general election? What would a reasonable person think? A reasonable person would think it's the upcoming general election. There were 23 industrial fires in Trinidad and Tobago from 2010 to 2013 from my quick research this morning. There have also been a number of residential fires. The Prime Minister announced that she will take to Cabinet a proposal to give a grant of $5,000 to some 200 employees left jobless following the fire at the supermarket. The Prime Minister would therefore be paying $1 million of taxpayers' money. All the fire victims in the past and in the future would claim entitlement to the same treatment. The act of the Prime Minister is the act of the government of Trinidad and Tobago, and therefore all similarly circumstanced persons would be entitled to get equal treatment from the government of Trinidad and Tobago. What is good for one must be good for all. The decision and action of the Prime Minister has serious implications for the past victims of fire and for the future victims of fire. The Constitution of Trinidad and Tobago in Section 4D requires the government to exercise its powers in such a way as not to discriminate against individuals and to treat persons equally. There is therefore the guarantee of equality of treatment in the Constitution in Trinidad and Tobago. In substance, therefore, democratic government, from what I have stated under the Constitution, means government of the people, by the people, and for the people. It is therefore undemocratic for the Prime Minister to ask the electorate to vote it back into government when the Prime Minister has failed to respond to actions and decisions of a government which cause public disquiet and condemnation. I therefore call upon the Prime Minister to justify to the electorate those decisions and actions which she and her government made and to give explanations to justify them. The Prime Minister must give full explanations in respect of those decisions and actions, and the explanations must be reasonable and acceptable. The Partnership Coalition in the election campaign of 2010 made several promises to the electorate and it gave several guarantees to them. The electorate relied on those promises and guarantees and voted them into power. The partnership government has, however, not kept some of those promises and some of those guarantees which it gave to the electorate. The government said it had a crime plan to make crime a problem of the past. The Prime Minister has instead been asking the Commissioner of Police to come up with a crime plan and to deal with the crime situation in Trinidad and Tobago, when the crime situation has not become better since 2010. The partnership promised in 2010 that it had a plan to turn around the economy. It would take immediate steps to diversify the economy. It would not be totally dependent on oil and gas. This was not done, and the economy is still totally dependent upon oil and gas, and the international monitors have given the economy negative rating. The Prime Minister promised to have a fixed date for general election. The Prime Minister in 2010 stated that no Prime Minister should have an election date in his or her back pocket. Well, we have seen that this Prime Minister kept the election date secret and did not announce it until June 2015. The Prime Minister stated that a plan to give greater power to the people every day of the five-year period before a general election. The plan was to pass a law so that the referenda in Trinidad and the people would be able to vote so that the government would be bound by the people vote every day of the 5 years. The government has not done that. The Prime Minister said she had a plan to change governance in Trinidad and Tobago to make it more open, transparent and accountable. The evidence shows that official corruption has been increased under this government. There are many promises and guarantees again, which have not been delivered. The Prime Minister, therefore, cannot legitimately or morally ask the electorate to vote it into government for a second term without first explaining and justifying to the electorate why she did not keep these guarantees that she gave to the electorate, which induced the electorate in 2010 to vote her into government for a first term. Quite apart from the failure of the Prime Minister to carry out her promises and guarantees to the electorate during the first term in government, the Prime Minister also refused to justify decisions and or actions made and which are taken by the government and which have caused public disquiet and public condemnation and which are still troubling the electorate. The Prime Minister must therefore, before the general elections on the 7th of September 2015, justify to the public those actions and or decisions. This is a condition precedent for the Prime Minister to expect the electorate to support her to get a second term. The failure by her to give adequate explanations to satisfy the electorate in respect of those decisions and or actions would entitle the electorate to draw adverse inference against her present promises when she said she had a plan, she has a plan, and she has a plan for Trinidad and Tobago. The principles of responsible government guaranteed in the Constitution of Trinidad and Tobago impose a political responsibility on the Prime Minister to give these explanations to the electorate. Some of these decisions and actions which the government has a duty to justify to the electorate relate to the following, and I call upon the Prime Minister to answer these questions. Why the Prime Minister knowingly allowed Section 34 alone of the Act, which contains several sections to be proclaimed, to come into effect as the laws of Trinidad and Tobago? Two, why the Prime Minister refused to have an independent investigation against her Attorney General conducted when the Solicitor General complained of prison gate? Why did the Prime Minister send a letter which the Solicitor General wrote to her complaining about matters in the Ministry of the Attorney General to the Attorney General for him to investigate? Why did the Prime Minister tell the public she was vindicated in the Emailgate probe when in truth and in fact the Office of the Commissioner of Police and the Office of the DPP made it clear that investigations against her were still ongoing? Why did the Prime Minister publicly attack the Deputy DPP for doing her duty in the Office of the DPP to continue the investigations into Emailgate? Why did the Prime Minister give the impression that the Integrity Commission exonerated her in the Emailgate probe when it was clear from the statements made by the Integrity Commission that it did not conduct a sufficient and full inquiry into Emailgate? Why did the Prime Minister permit the Minister of Sports to continue in office after it was crystal clear that his continuation in office was not in the public interest? Why did the Prime Minister support the former Attorney General Anand Ramlogan in Westgate when it was clear that Mr. David West did his duty in giving a witness statement in support of the Leader of the Opposition in his defense to the libel claim filed against him by Mr. Anand Ramlogan? Why did the Prime Minister in an address to the nation on Westgate support a former Attorney General and condemn Mr. David West and former Minister of National Security, Mr. Gary Griffith, who stood up for the truth? If the Prime Minister had a crime plan in 2010 to fix the crime, why did she create a state of emergency to fight crime? The next question, the Prime Minister must explain whether there is a new political party in Trinidad and Tobago named Kamala 2015. I know of the UNC, I know of the partnership. The campaign by the governing party is now Kamala 2015. Is there a new political party? I merely want to tell you and to tell the population of Trinidad and Tobago, history has shown that when a leader determines that there should be a cult, that leader then becomes a dictator. If you want to read history, read Mugabe, read Idi Amin, read Saddam, read Hitler, read Burnham, and read Eric Gehry. Is Kamala 2015 the predecessor to dictatorship in Trinidad and Tobago? Thank you very much. Well, when you look at the proposal by the government for the runoff bill, and the government had indicated that it was going to pass that bill, even though there was no consultation, it affected the rights in the Constitution. And the government was stubborn, and it was not until the Privy Council decided in the St. Kitts case that the court had the power, even in an election matter, to determine whether the government was being fair to the population. Remember, the Privy Council granted an injunction against the St. Kitts government for using new boundaries for the general election, which was not fair to the population of St. Kitts. And based on that injunction, the St. Kitts government obviously lost the election, and the elections were conducted on the old boundaries. You remember the whole system of voting in Trinidad and Tobago was going to be changed overnight. And it was only when that decision was given, and we made it clear, and I made it clear at the law meeting at the law school that weekend, that if the government proceeded with that bill, I was going to use the St. Kitts case to get an injunction against the government from using that law to conduct the election. Now, when a government decides to do that, obviously it brings into the question as to dictatorship. And I'm on record as saying that what the government did in expelling or in suspending the leader of the opposition is wrong in principle. It was illegal, it was unconstitutional, and the government knew that if Mr. Rowley had taken her to court, he would have ultimately succeeded, but it would have been determined way after the general elections. And therefore, I was very outspoken on that. And I have not been only outspoken against this government when it has trampled upon the rights of people. I have spoken out generally against any government which has trampled upon the rights of people. So I think that one of the areas in this election would be the question of whether the Prime Minister is dictatorial. And when you see that within the UNC itself, there has been no internal elections in the party, the institutions of the UNC have not been functioning. I am a member of the UNC. I have not been invited to a meeting. There have been no machinery functioning in the UNC. It's a dictatorial operation. As a matter of fact, in this election, the UNC is left out. There is no UNC party contesting this election. If you had to have candidates chosen under the UNC constitution, the people in the constituency would have a say, the party groups would have a say, all those things are not followed. And therefore, I think that really and truly, there has been dictatorial tendencies by this government. Well, it has been repeatedly stated that when a public official is in an acting appointment for a long period of time, it puts a lot of pressure upon the public officials, especially where it's dependent upon the political directorate to be confirmed. And that is why the service commissions are entrenched in such a way that people would have security of tenure. When a police officer in that position is acting for a long period of time, although he believes that he is independent and he is not towing the line of the government, the public perception would be that he is towing the line. And it's unfair to him. It's unfair to him to have him acting for so long. And the government must take the full responsibility for having him acting for so long. And therefore, you have a situation in which major police investigations, the public do not know what is happening. And I could tell you, when I operated as Attorney General, there was a situation where within the police service, the police on its own motion would carry on investigations. And it's the same police service which worked very efficiently under the UNC administration. As a matter of fact, Janet Reno, the AG of USA, when she came to Trinidad and Tobago, said that the Trinidad and Tobago Police Service was the leading police service in the region in the fight against crime. So this country, it has to do with leadership. And I make no apologies for saying it. This country over the last 5 years did not have proper leadership. This country needs strong and proper leadership. I can't tell you who will give you that leadership, but it needs strong leadership. And that is why these elections are very important for the people of Trinidad and Tobago. Whichever party one belongs to, whichever party one supports, the fact of the matter is that we are all citizens of Trinidad and Tobago. And we can see it before our eyes what has happened and what can happen. And that is why I consider that I have a duty to assist the population in explaining its use. I can't tell people how to vote and what to vote, but I think the people need assistance for them to make assessments, and that is what I intend to do. Well, I think that is a question which the Prime Minister should answer. And the Prime Minister has a responsibility. That's some of the things I've been talking about today. A Prime Minister should not be having a campaign and saying, give me another term, without telling the population, giving explanation as to some of the major issues affecting the country. And the question of the Commissioner of Police acting for so long and not being in a confirmed position, and crime, the fight against crime being adversely affected, the Prime Minister must deal with that. That is more important for the Prime Minister to deal with than to take to Cabinet a note to give compensation for fire victims when she has never done that before. Yes, you want to call them in? Well, the court will determine how it's going to proceed with the trial. You could do me a favor, ask Mr. Mohammed and the other person to come in. When the matter comes up, in the matter which was filed by Mr. Eli, the state has not put in an affidavit as yet. And the state will have an opportunity to put in an affidavit in respect of this matter. But the court will hear what the state has, and then the court will make a decision in the matter. I bring in Mr. Mohammed. I'll make him. This is Mr. Ashmeed Mohammed. I informed the media about your arrest and detention in the case that has been filed. So obviously they may want to. Mr. Patil has arrived in from. Have a seat. You could talk to the media. Feel free to talk to them. You could tell them what you want to tell me.
Okay. My name is Ashmeed Mohammed. No, I wasn't detained in Venezuela. I never traveled to Venezuela.
This is the second person who filed the action is now in Venezuela. That's yeah. Pitilal.
Well, recently, on the 24th of July, I was traveling into Canada with my wife and two children. And I was stopped at the airport. The flight attendant told me that I could no longer, I didn't get clearance from the Canadian Border Control to get into Canada. So that's something going on right now. I called the RCMP in Canada, Brampton, and they told me that the reason why you cannot come into Canada is because you're on a no-fly list. And I asked them why I'm on a no-fly list, and they said because of your terrorist activities. And I said, well, what terrorist activities are you talking about? He said your terrorist activities with ISIS, and I want to believe that's because of the news reporter that reported on another media, on a media house, I don't want to call it a media house name or the reporter name, but he had run a story on the media saying that I was in Syria fighting with ISIS, and he showed a picture with somebody looking like me that appeared on the New York Times, on the New York Post magazine, and he said that was me fighting in Syria. And you know, he played off this with the incident where I was arrested and detained for alleged plot that I wanted to kill the Prime Minister and Minister of the Governments as well. So you know, it's just a spin-off from this issue. So the plot that was plotted against us, the Muslim, and I was put in jail for about 13 days or so, it's haunting me now. Now I cannot go back to Canada because of this. So, inshallah, we hope to clear that up in court. Mm-hmm. Any questions? No, they stopped me at the Piaco Port, well, let's call it Port of Spain, but Piaco International Airport. I was stopped there. And they said my wife and two children could travel, but I cannot travel. My wife didn't want to go without me, so. Well, I'm not employed right now, but I do a little farming in Rio Claro. Yeah. My mom is a cancer patient and physically challenged person. So she was in the hospital last year when I went September, October to visit her. She's in the hospital now again. She always go every so often. In Canada, she's in the Canada, in a hospital in Canada, right? And she's sick, and she's an old lady, so now if she should die, Allah forbid, before I get this thing cleared up, I hope to get it cleared up. But if she should die now, I cannot go to visit my mom or my brother in Canada. And that's how sad this has turned out to be for me. Thanks to the government of Trinidad and Tobago, and now this news reporter. Yeah, I used to do some business in Trinidad. I used to bring in some containers from China and sell goods. Sometimes I'd buy goods locally and sell. But after this incident where the government plotted a plot against us, and up to now the government hasn't even investigated who plotted the plot against the Muslim, against us. But that destroyed my life. And it's continuing to haunt me more now because I'm a red flag now. So if I bring a continent into Trinidad in the port, they would go inside there and they would take everything out and they would ransack the container. So I would get broken goods. And then in the port itself, it have a set of people just help themselves. So when I get my container, I'm losing goods and I'm getting damaged goods. It's not at all feasible for me to stay in this business, so I stopped doing that business now. I'm just in Rio Claro living off my savings, which is going down.
Why are they associated with
ISIS? The reporter on the New York Post, there was a picture of some Islamic militants holding up a wreckage of an aircraft that they claimed that they had shot down. And there is a person there with a machine gun then. I think it's an AK. And he said his picture is slightly resembling mine. So as a result of that, this reporter showed the picture to maybe someone in Trinidad. And that's what he's saying in the story. And he said that that people are certain that this is Ashmeed Mohammed. Now, what happened at the same time that this reporter found this picture, I was in Canada. If you look at the date on the columns there, it say that the picture was found on the 16th of September, 2014. I was in Canada on the 11th of September 2014. So I was out of the country. So he probably tried to get me by phone. Nobody could get hold of me. So he went with the assumption Ashmeed is in Syria and this is Ashmeed Mohammed fighting. But the dates would show. I have my passport to show the date that I enter Canada. There's no way I could be. It's impossible for me to be in Trinidad I mean, in ISIS, in fighting with ISIS in Syria and in Canada at the same time. No, Ashmeet Mohammed. I don't know if he is linked, but no. My brother, I only have one brother. His name is Shaikul Mohammed. He lives in Canada.
One is Venezuela's brother.
Oh, okay.
The one in Venezuela that I am representing is Dominic Pichilal.
Okay. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, my pastor. Yeah. Yes, we have. My lawyer is Farid Schoon.
The passport.
Yeah, and he is. Yeah, let me just get this out here. So, all right, so this here is my, can zoom up on that?
Open it.
Yeah, all right. This page, bio page, that's me. That's me there. You guys got that? So that's the that's my Canadian passport. Okay. And my four souvenirs from the airline now. These are the boarding passes that we was going to use to get on the plane. So we was in the gallery waiting area to get on the plane when my name was announced. When my name was announced to come to the counter, and the flight attendant said, sorry, Mr. Mohammed, and this is about 1 o'clock in the morning here now. Sorry, Mr. Mohammed, the Canadian Border Control did not give you permission to come into Canada. I went to the Canadian Embassy. They said we will find out. We see your name, your passport is blocked from traveling into Canada, but we don't know why. We're going to find out. Up to now, they haven't had a word to say to me. So I went on my own digging, and that's how I called the RCMP in Canada, and they told me that I'm a terrorist. And we have three cases now, right? Well, one is we suing, Mr. Maharaj is suing, on behalf of me, suing the government for
Constitutional relief.
And I have Farid Schoon, who's a lawyer in Port of Spain. He is suing the media house and the reporter and all of that for the ISIS story. I have only one. I have a case going on in the Coover Magistrate Court where I bring in a container, and I always get goods that I didn't put on that I didn't order. And there was some kind of mix-up there where they say they found a bow and arrow and some slinging shot and some, like, hunting gears, you know, stuff like that, and some pepper spray and stuff like that. In the container, I didn't order that, and it was on my invoice. But they say, once it's in the container, it's yours. So that's the case I have going on in the court. No, and I have a clean criminal record. I have a good character in Canada and Trinidad. So I'm a law-abiding citizen, to the best of my knowledge. I'm not in no terrorist activities, and it's just sad. What has been happening to my life now? Yeah.
Okay. That's it. Anything else? sent to me.
Okay, good, right. So make sure.
Members of the media, thank you very much for coming. Everybody got a copy of the statement I made? Okay. It's not on the table yet?